Well, good evening. It's difficult for me to say evening. I almost wanted to say morning. I see everybody's in their Sunday morning spots, too. Okay, all right, there's a few. You are creatures of habits. Well, good evening and welcome to our Maundy Thursday service. I saw a friend who's a pastor in the conference say that his child asked him why there was a tent outside the Pentecostal church this week, and he said, well, that's because they're doing a revival. And his child asked, well, what is a revival? And he said, well, they go to church every night. And he said, but we're not doing that right now. And she said, well, we went to church last night and we're going tonight. And he said, I guess you're right. It's kind of a revival. So think of this as a time to gather once again tonight for another church service, and then tomorrow for our Good Friday service. But welcome, and tonight we remember the Last Supper, and it's Maundy Thursday, and it stands for the Latin mandatum. Can you say mandatum? There you go. And it means mandate, because today or tonight is our mandate to love one another, and that is our message today, to love one another. If you would, please pray with me, and then we will begin. Most gracious and loving God, we give you thanks this night for the ability once again to gather as your church and remember the week of your passion. Lord, tonight we remember how you ate with the disciples, how you showed them what it was like to love one another and to serve. And Lord, we know that you ate with sinners. Bless us this night and help us to be your people who learn to love one another as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord, you are so precious to me.
You are so precious to me.
Right. Our scripture reading for this evening comes to us from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 1 through 17, and then 31 through 35. Oops, skip that. I am doing 12 through 17 and 31 through 35, keeping you on your toes. Hear now the word of the Lord according to the Gospel of John. After he had washed their feet, he put on his robe and had returned to the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new command, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another, the word of God for the people of God."
Thanks be to God.
I love the enthusiasm tonight. Well, Maundy Thursday is perhaps one of the most significant days in the Christian year. It's not Easter or Christmas. It doesn't always get the same attention as Good Friday, but its significance cannot be overstated. And so tonight, we remember it. It comes from the Latin mandatum, meaning mandate or commandment, because on this day, we are given the mandate and the command to love one another. Tonight's often filled with people remembering the Last Supper by taking communion, as we're going to do tonight. Some churches, believe it or not, also do foot washings. And I know how uncomfortable that makes some of you. But ask yourself why, because I'm sure it was uncomfortable for the disciples too when Jesus washed their feet. We tell the story of Jesus washing the disciples' feet and acknowledge the mandate to love one another on this night. Love one another as I have loved you. And as he was saying this, let us not forget that Jesus also shared the table with all of his disciples, including Judas. We are living in a time where so many outside and yes, inside the church do not want to have anything to do with each other. If you have even the slightest disagreement theologically or politically, it's all too easy for us to defriend people on Facebook we disagree with because we don't like their opinions. And we even go to the lengths of severing ties with those we've worshiped alongside for years and even decades. We can become a people who are quick to anger and slow to forgive. But remember that Jesus ate with the man who turned him over to be crucified. Remember that Jesus loved his enemies and ate with all sinners. Remember and do not forget the love that our Lord shared with all the people. And so tonight we remember the sacrifice of love that Jesus gave to share in a meal with a bunch of messed up disciples who did not always get along, who did not always get it right, who were too scared to stand with Jesus, who denied him, who ran and forgot all that they had been taught. And Jesus once again tells us to love one another as I have loved you. So you lucked out tonight. We're not washing any feet. Very good. Although it would be one of the most profound expressions of compassion that you could show another person. But it feels uncomfortable because no one should have to wash someone else's feet. Jesus didn't have to do it, but he did it out of service and out of love. He demonstrated for us what it looks like to be a humble leader, to lead through service. Jesus showed us how we ought to think of ourselves and of others. On this night, his last night with the disciples, Jesus taught through his words and his actions what it means to be a Christian, a disciple, and a follower of Christ. It means inviting everyone to the table, even those you don't get along with. Because the way we treat each other matters to God. It means serving one another to the point of uncomfortability. Because we are to treat others better than we treat ourselves. In one evening, one night, that really mattered, Jesus instituted the sacrament and illustrated the greatest commandment. And that was to love the Lord our God and to love our neighbor as ourselves. And so this evening, we'll get to partake in communion around this table together as we put aside all the differences that we have with one another to remember Jesus' command to love one another. In just a moment, we'll get ready to take up our offering if we have some ushers available for that. But first, I'd like to introduce you to my good friend, Reverend Sam Metters. She is a deacon in the conference. We have a long history, too. She was actually, over Corey and I, a mentor over our provisional group before we were ordained. I will let Sam tell you a little bit about who she is and also about the mission that she's a part of, which is Project Transformation.
Thanks, Dan. First of all, I just want to say it's such a joy and a pleasure to be here tonight. I grew up in Benton. I am very much familiar with your church, very much familiar with this community, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to be here tonight. You'll notice one thing I do want to point out, because we talked about it, is you'll notice that I wear a sash as opposed to a stole like Dan, and that's because I'm a deacon. So my call is to serve the church in the community, to be a bridge between the church and the world. And the way that I get to do that is as the executive director of a nonprofit in Pine Bluff that focuses on literacy development and social emotional learning for children in that community. It's a wonderful way to be involved in the church. We host summer day camp programs for kids in two of our United Methodist churches in that community. And we invite churches to partner with us to come read with those kids. Kids who are in kindergarten to sixth grade come. We have about 65 kids that we're planning on having for the summer, and we hire about 10 college students to live in community together, to do what the disciples did, which is wander around in work, wander around in finding their calling, and be with one another together as they lead children into lives of faith and hope and love. And so again, I'm so grateful to be here and so grateful to be with you all this evening.
I'll say to you that not tell Sam I was doing this. Sam just came to help us during communion, and she'll be here tomorrow to help during our Good Friday service. But I thought it would be a great opportunity for us to take up an offering for Project Transformation and a great Lenten practice to give back to. I want you to know that, and correct me if I'm saying this incorrectly, but those students who come for how many weeks is it?
8 weeks.
8 weeks. They pay $20 to put their kids through this literacy program for 8 weeks because of the donations that we give, because of the support from churches just like ours. And so we can really help those kids grow and not fall back during the summer. Not only that, those college students who are coming are getting a taste of what it looks like to do ministry, and we are developing their call because we need more pastors. We need more people who are serving the church. So Project Transformation is great for that. Again, if you could, you can donate to the church and just mark in the memo line Project Transformation. So make it out to the church and then Project Transformation or PT in the memo line, and we'll know where it's going. Let us pray for the offerings. Lord God, we give you thanks tonight for the ways in which you've shown your love for us, the ways in which it's made known through bread and through wine, the ways, Lord, in which you've served even the least among us. We ask, Lord, that you'd help us to give back this day, to remember your Lenten journey and the ways in which we sacrificed for you. Lord, bless these offerings. May they go to further your kingdom and help your people, to bring literacy to children and callings to young people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Go!
you all would please stand and join us in the doxology.
1, 2.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Take a moment to confess your sins before God in silent prayer. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
Amen. And now let us join together as we begin the great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You formed from the earth you brought forth bread and created the fruit of the vine. You formed us in your image, delivered us from captivity, and make covenant with us to be our sovereign God. You fed us manna in the wilderness and gave grapes as evidence of the promised land. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When we had turned aside from your way and abused your gifts, you gave us in him your crowning gift. Emptying himself that our joy might be full, he fed the hungry. He healed the sick. He ate with the scorned and the forgotten. He washed his disciples' feet and gave a holy meal as a pledge of his abiding presence. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, thank you. He took the bread. He gave thanks to you, broke it, gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which has been given for you. And after the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to the disciples and said, drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. And so in remembrance, these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving, a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we all feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
The table has been set, and you are invited to come forward.
As we prepare for our final hymn, we will begin the stripping of the altar as a reminder that they took our Lord Jesus from us on this night. And then we'll remember his crucifixion tomorrow. But as we take this, as the altar gets stripped, it will be a somber process, and we will not have that joy come back again until Easter morning. So from this night onward, we long for Easter sunrise. Amen. If you would, please join in our final hymn.
This is probably a hymn that you haven't sung a whole lot, but it has very, very good words. So I'm going to play all the way through it. We are going to play all the way through it first. Okay.
Amen. May you go in peace, longing for the resurrection of our Lord, knowing that even in the darkest of places, the Lord will walk with you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.